Greetings. Owner Dogen, you have raised a great question, brother. You said Paul didn't abolish the law, but he did. He taught not to follow the law anymore. He said that through the death of Christ, the law ended and the slavery to the law is over. He even called the law our enemy and a curse. These are Satan's words, not Jesus' words. The Old Testament calls the law perfect and a blessing from God. Paul is the wolf in sheep's clothing. It's the same way how Adam and Eve broke God's law through Satan. And I appreciate, brother, that you have provided quite a few scriptures which have shaped your thinking. For the moment, I will just give the references. This topic will honestly take more than one video even to begin to answer clearly. Ephesians 2:14, Acts 21:20, Romans 6:14, Galatians 5:18, Romans 10:4, Galatians 5:2, and Galatians 3:13. Did Paul abolish the law? There is so much confusion in that accusation, brother, that I first need to just list general problems. Number one, the law was given to Jews, not the Gentiles, to observe. Two, Jesus came and fulfilled the law, and by doing so, completed man's obligation to it. Three, Paul taught only what was written in the scriptures, and how Christ fulfilled them. Four, God endorsed Paul with signs and miracles, and even Islam says the signs are with God. Five, Paul was an apostle to the Gentiles, not the Jews. Six, Paul's message from God for the Gentiles was given by Jesus directly to Paul. Seven, Paul's message was confirmed by Peter, a companion of Jesus, and a Jew. Each of these points has meaning and significance, brother, but deserves scriptural support. Did Paul abolish the law? So point one, the law was given to Jews, not to Gentiles to observe. I hope that is reasonably self-evident to you, brother. Some parts of the law were to be observed by strangers, but not every point. Some points were even prohibited. Exodus 12:48. If a stranger shall sojourn with you and would keep the Passover of the Lord, let all his males be circumcised. Then he may come near and keep it. He shall be as a native in the land, or of the land, but no uncircumcised person shall eat of it. So the law was given to Jews to observe. And the law was given for another purpose. The law was a teacher, a master, to educate. Galatians 3:24, so the law became our guardian. The law guarded over and protected. So the law became our guardian to lead us to Christ, that we might be justified by faith. Point two, Jesus came and fulfilled the law, and by doing so completed man's obligation to it. When an obligation or a contract is fulfilled, there need be no more subjugation to it. This is really important to understand about God's covenant being fulfilled. Jesus came to fulfill the law and fulfill the obligation to the law, not abolish it. Matthew 5:17, do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. And yet what Jesus accomplished has changed the position of the law as a necessity. Romans 10:4, Christ is the end of the law, in order to bring righteousness to everyone who believes. You see, brother, it is Christ, the Messiah, the Messiah, who has ended by completing the law. And it is this act by which God has given us forgiveness and righteousness, which we could have never obtained ourselves. Romans 3:21. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been revealed, being borne witness to by the law and the prophets. The law and the prophets confirm this planned action by God. Notice that this is apart from the law. But now, apart from the law. The law could never make us holy. Never. And the righteousness of God is through faith from Christ Jesus toward all those believing. For there is no distinction. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. All means Jews and Gentiles alike. One purpose of the law was to convince us that we could not keep the law by our own power. God showed us that we have all fallen short, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So what the law could not do, make us holy before God, God has done for us. God presented Him, Jesus, as an atoning sacrifice through faith in His blood, in order to demonstrate His, or God's, righteousness, because in His forbearance He had passed over the sins committed beforehand. He did this to demonstrate His righteousness at this present time, so as to be just and to justify the one who has faith in Jesus. Where then is boasting? It is excluded. You see, brother, if God allowed you to earn your salvation, you would have cause to boast. Can any man stand before God and demand entrance to paradise for his own purity, perfection? No, brother. No man can make such a demand because man is sinful. So what is our only chance then? There are really only two choices. One, you believe a religion where you can never know until after death. Or two, God creates a religion where He provides the salvation to those who desire it. Where then is boasting? It is excluded. On what principle? On that of works? No, but on that of faith. God has provided the solution, salvation for the humble who are willing to receive God's free gift to them. The law exists to teach you and convince you that you need that salvation. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. This is the conclusion of men learned in the Scriptures and the law and the prophets. After all, is God the God of the Jews only? Isn't He also the God of the Gentiles? Of course He is. Since indeed God, who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith, is one. So, brother, the Word of God explains all that needs to be understood. But the religion that wrongly damns you to balance your own scales in fear and uncertainty has no answers and cannot even speak to the logic of God designing His plan of salvation. Did Paul abolish the law? No, it was Christ who fulfilled the law to fulfill the promise of God to Abraham. Genesis 22:18, "And in thy seed shall all the nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice." The covenant with Abraham was marked by physical circumcision. Circumcision is an act that cuts away a piece of flesh. But the prophets of God revealed another circumcision, of cutting away the evil in our hearts. Deuteronomy 10:16, "So circumcise your heart and stiffen your neck no longer." Deuteronomy 30 verse 6, "And the Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the heart of your offspring, so that you will love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and that you may live." Jeremiah 4 4, "Circumcise yourselves to the Lord and remove the foreskins of your heart, men of Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem, or else my wrath will go forth like fire and burn with none to quench it because of the evil of your deeds." Jeremiah 24 7, "I will give them a heart to know me, for I am the Lord, and they will be my people, and I will be their God, for they will return to me with their whole heart." And Paul, who was learned by the standards of men, was taught by the God of Abraham. He was taught to understand the message of the prophets and called by God to proclaim it to the Gentiles. Romans 2:28, "For he is not a Jew who is one outwardly, nor is circumcision that which is outward in the flesh. No, a man is a Jew because he is one inwardly, and circumcision is a matter of the heart, by the Spirit," meaning the Spirit of God, "not by the written code. Such a man's praise does not come from men, but from God." And this too is confirmed by the prophets. Jeremiah 9:25, "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, that I will punish all who are circumcised and yet uncircumcised." This is a warning from Almighty God, brother, both to Jews who are physically circumcised and to Muslims who think their circumcision protects them. You are uncircumcised in your heart. The one who is physically uncircumcised yet keeps the law will condemn you who, even though you have the written code and circumcision, are a lawbreaker. No, Paul did not abolish the law. Paul revealed the true meaning. This is such a rich topic, brother. I think I should continue this as a series. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.